Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Can I please invite you to take a seat? We will begin momentarily. We are running a bit late, but that is because the discussions have been so intense and stimulating and interesting that we want them to continue. Unfortunately, we have a schedule to respect, so we will need to carry on now. So for this next session, I will invite the moderator of the panel, Mrs. Marion Jansen, Chief Economist of ITC, to come up to the stage and take the floor. Marion?
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for being here for this session. We have a hard time with this session this morning because we are very much behind on schedule, and we have to follow up on what has been a passionate session on the future of Africa in global trade just before us. The panel is going to continue to talk about, of course, integration and the role of TPOs in this. But we are going to look at the kind of problems you can encounter when trying to export to your partners. Sometimes your partners, be they the country you export to, be they the lead firm, the multinational you want to attract to your country, sometimes these partners expect you to meet certain standards or to stick to certain regulations. And we have at ITC dedicated our annual report, our SME competitiveness outlook this year to this topic, meeting the standard for trade. I think the report was mentioned earlier in this event. Now, meeting the standard for trade sounds quite easy, sounds potentially cool, is in reality often challenging, and this is one of the issues we will want to discuss in this session, Global Value Chains in 2025, the standards for trade. I'm very happy to welcome a very prominent high-level panel for this, and I'm going to call them to the podium one by one. I would like to start to invite and you to welcome Dato Zul Mahmood from MaTrade Malaysia. Please welcome also with me Ms. Indira Malwate, Chairperson and CEO of the Export Development Board of Sri Lanka. Mr. Mokhtaba Koshwatai, Deputy Minister of Mine, Industry and Trade of the Islamic Republic of Iran and the CEO of the TPO of Iran. Thank you for welcoming him. Ms. Adriana Rodriguez, Competitiveness Coordinator from APEX Brazil. And last but not least, Mr. Larry Atipo, International Development Director from Fair Trade International Ghana. Thank you for being with me here. I already mentioned that we have a challenge with time. We start very late. And one of our speakers, the Deputy Minister from Iran, will have to leave at 1 o'clock. So if you see him jumping up in the middle of the session, it's not because he dislikes us or the audience, but because he has to catch a flight. I would like to start by inviting all of you to make a short intervention on the topic that we want to address in this session. The Deputy Minister will speak a bit longer than the others because he may have only one chance to speak. I will get back to the others. And I would like to start with Ms. Indira Malwate. Ms. Malwate, your country has embarked on a rather ambitious road to a more active and a new type of integration in the global world, in international trade. It's a new phase for your country where you do not want to become only very integrated, but also to move up the value chains. Please let us know which are the challenges and opportunities you encounter in this work.
Good afternoon, and may I first thank ITC and the Morocco Promotion Office, and two special ladies, Arancha and Zara, for inviting the Sri Lanka Export Development Board to be a panelist at this networking session. Sri Lanka, as you may know, is a very small country. It has a population of 22 million, and therefore, when it comes to the local market, it's hardly a market that we have. So therefore, we have to depend a lot on exports. So in the context of exports, we always talk of global production networks, we talk of global value chains. In fact, more recently, it has become far more fashionable to talk of GVCs and GPNs. But in Sri Lankan context, we've been exporting primary exports for a fairly long period, which was tea, rubber, coconut, but we have gone into value addition products. Now, for example, if you take the rubber sector, we've been doing latex, but now we have gone, Sri Lanka has almost 38% of the world market for pneumatic tires is Sri Lanka. So I would, we don't assemble vehicles in Sri Lanka, but doing the pneumatic tire is being part of the global value chain. Similarly, we are an exporter of fruit and vegetable from Sri Lanka. And the immense standard qualities that our companies have to face, especially the SMEs, is tormenting. I mean, it's a nightmare sometimes. So these are some of the things that when it comes to standards, if I would like to give an example, you take Sri Lanka, I'm sure lots of people don't know, is exporter of strawberries to the world. We have met the highest standards, which are what Marks and Spencer's requires, which is a field-to-fork audit. You try to, you are okay with Europe with those standards, but when it comes to more the regional markets, those standards are not accepted. So where do the SMEs stand? And as you know, most of the standards are very costly. It's very time costly, and time consuming and costly. So what does the TPO do for the SME sector? So we have a number of schemes that we have adopted. One thing is we work with our regulators, because regulators is a group that we have to work with, because you have the standard institutions, you have the customs, you have a number of regulators who could be the blocking, who could be the ones who are not conducive for us, our exporters, to help them to export. So we go on the basis that let's have ease of doing business. Now, in this morning, they were speaking of a one-stop shop. Sri Lanka doesn't believe in this one-stop shop. We believe in having the ease of doing business for our SME exporters, because that helps them, the regulators, to help them to export. Now, again, when I take the example of strawberries, we have got the standards of global gap certification. Now that is again another costly operation. For therefore, Sri Lanka has adopted its own standards, which we call Lankan gap, for which we have got ITC assistance, and we managed to assist a group of farmers and as trainers, and in turn these trainers help large groups of farmers. So once they adhere to the Sri Lankan gap, it becomes very much easier for them to reach the next standard, which is a global gap. So these are a few initiatives taken by my organization. We also assist the SME sector by helping them. We give a grant of wanted to do the ISO standards or HACCP standards. These are all extended only to the SME sector, because we believe the large exporters can afford it, and the large exporters of Sri Lanka in rubber and in apparel. So all of them have the necessary investment to go into standards. If you even take the apparel standards, you have one company which requires a different standard. For example, the electrical conduits. One says it should be 1.5 over the floor level, when you come for the next audit, they say it should be two feet over this thing. Now, where do small companies stand with these numerous standards? So the ideal is that we don't have company standards coming in or the buyer standards coming in, is if we can all integrate and have accepted international standards.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you for giving such concrete examples. You mentioned a number of issues that came also prominently in the report. We mentioned this need to work with the regulator. When working in the trade community, we sometimes tend to think trade is the center of the world. But in order to export, there is this whole regulatory aspect that involves other institutions that are important. Also, interesting, the description of these challenges to export. I attended yesterday, I told you, a meeting with a number of European participants, and there the concern is just, maybe those countries don't want to meet standards. Those countries, they are far away. And how challenging it is to meet them, in particular if they differ across countries, that's often not, often consumers in the partner country are not aware of that. Deputy Minister Touch, I was allowed to pronounce the name in a shorter way because I didn't manage to pronounce the full one. I mentioned Sri Lanka is embarking on a new period of internationalization. For Iran, something even newer has started. How is it for your country to enter this world of global actors, of global trade flows, and of global, regional, or national standards?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I'm very glad to have this opportunity to be among our friends in different areas of the world, especially from Trade Promotion Organization. And I think for all of you, maybe for most of you, would be very interesting to know about what Iran is going to enhance his trade in the global chain. Although we have been in sanction for almost maybe 14 years, we have been almost engaged in war when Iraq started after just our revolution. So we have had a very difficult times in the past, I can say 37 years. And we have to see such kind of economy which has experienced such kind of hard times, how is able or how is ready to go on the global value chain, which without having proper foreign trade cooperation and link through the banks and through the routes, delivery, transportation, and so on. So how these jobs could be done? And what could be the barriers in our view compared to the others that they have not had such kind of difficulty in the past? For your information, first of all, I have to say what the world knows about Iran is completely different from what is actually Iran. So I will invite always the companies, the countries, responsible people to have the chance to visit Iran and to have the opportunity to see the facts in Iran. The economy of Iran is very, in my view, and those who have seen, is strong enough to resist on our foots. We have established an economy which is following the resilience economic system. It is a system that you are mostly relying on your local production, and you are not too much affected by the foreign fluctuations, by international fluctuations in the economic field. So I am proud to say that today, if you visit in Iran, many responsible ministers and deputy ministers that who have visited Iran, at the end of their trips, they have told me that it is very rare case country that we can see that they are touching every area of production. If today you visit Iran, you will see the economy has increased in different sectors, in different area. Some part is because of the war and some part because of the sanction. We had to follow such kind of a strategy because today economists will not suggest that in each area you have to go in the production. They will see what is your comparative advantage, what is your competitive advantage, and you have to follow these rules. And from that respect, if we want to go to the international market, maybe we have to restructure our industry, to what extent all these productions are competitive, and we would be able to compete with our competitors. But anyhow, whether we like it or we don't like it, we had to go in this policy to insist on our self-sufficiency, and the result is satisfactory. I cannot say we are not satisfied with that. It is satisfactory result, because in any area we are testing the local manufacturing result. It is not with FDI, it is mostly local, because when I say our trade turnover is $160 billion, maybe for many of you think that $160 billion is not a very big figure. Yes, we have the country that you are with the $300 billion or $400 billion, but when we go in details of the economy, we will see most of these earnings are coming from the investment of foreign companies, and the country itself cannot touch or cannot have a tangible assets or earnings. Or maybe their earning is mostly about the employment and about the taxes and so on and so. But the real earning goes to the pocket of those international companies that who have invested and they are exporting. But here in Iran, the case is different. So you will see Iranian local manufacturing company, they are producing, and in very limited area, we have foreign direct investment involved. Just for your information, if I want to give you some figures in some area, for example, in petrochemicals, most of you knows Iran as an oil country. And maybe if more than that, carpet of Iran is very famous, pistachio from Iran is very famous, that's all most of the foreign knows about Iran. But if I say to you that our dependency on the oil is almost 30%, we used to have 95% dependency on the crude oil exportation, but nowadays our budget is running with maximum 30% dependency on the oil. So it means we have done a lot of non-oil revenue in our economy, so we are really depending on our local production and foreign earning from the non-oil exportation. On the petrochemicals, just for your information, almost 60 million tons is the amount of the production. We have a very good, I should say, local value chain in the petrochemical industry. We are going from the gas resources to the textile industry. We go from the gas resources to the polymers, to the plastics. So when you see regional or local value chain is well established, is well organized, when we want to talk to go on the global, then there are some barriers that I will touch it later. On the cement industry, almost 80 million tons of production of the cement. Some people consider the industrialization of a country based on the production of the cement industry. It is 80 million tons of the cement industry. On the ceramic, it is almost 600 million square meter. Car industry, we are producing more than 1.3 million units of car in the region. Maybe we are number two after Turkey, and I think within the whole Africa and Middle East, maybe we are competing with, South Africa. The number of the cars that presently, the capacity which has been established, it is 1.9 million units per year, and presently we are producing 1.3 million units of car. So when we look also to the value, almost 1,200 spare parts manufacturer. Inside Iran, they are producing all kind of spare parts which are needed for the car industry. So the whole value chain inside Iran with the proper R&D and with the proper associations are operating. But if we are going to have these spare parts in the international market or in the global value chain, then the story will be different that I will say later. Anyhow, in the aluminum, in the copper, our ranking, we are one of the richest country in the region in regard of the mining sector. And we believe mining sector would be our competitive advantage in the future, which could be replaced very easily. Instead of exporting crude oil, we can rely on that. And also on the gas resources, which is well known to you. On the, tire and tube industry, on the tractor industry, on the, refrigerator, home appliances, I can say we are 100% self-sufficient in the home appliances production. So to be frank with you, from the production level, from the I mean, self-sufficiency, we have done a very good job, but when it comes to the subject of the how globally this could be done, I believe this is for all the TPO. Development can come with the plan, with the goals, with the objectives, and with the program. We cannot leave development in each area, in every area, whether in the export or in the industrialization. Development is not something that we can leave it to the market elements. And we say, okay, we leave it to the market, and market will tell us where to go and how to go. I believe such kind of export plan requires goals and objectives, and we need some development organization to follow these goals and these objectives. It is not a subject of the market. I myself, in my experience with the Western countries, with the industrial countries, whenever I talked, I saw in different manner. Just yesterday, the gentleman that was from Netherlands, he mentioned that Dutch diamond, he was in fact insisting that development or to choose the proper sector requires, I mean, a collaboration of different sectors or different elements. One of them is the government. So in my view, and this has been experienced in my country, if we have been able to do a very big job in the petrochemicals because we had a development organization, National Petrochemical Company, in charge of expansion of petrochemicals. Today we have such kind of organizations for the mining sectors. We are weak in some area that we have not introduced such kind of organization to trace and to support the expansion of that part. So it is essential. If we would like to have some roles or some chances or some part of the global value chain, we have to have to moderate, we have to, I mean, manage such kind of plan. This is not something that we will ask from the SME, okay, go ahead and find your partner or find your position in the global value chain. The government should come, TPO should come, and should support SME in order to have a proper chances in the value chain. We have done these jobs with different value chain, big value chains, and a leading company in the Asia and in the Europe. We have been starting talking one by one. This is our capacity, this is our position, this is our SME, competitiveness, and we would like that such kind of positions to be considered for them. So I think such kind of, tailor-made or such kind of take care program is necessary in order to put positions for the SME in order to be able to go within the global value chain. The second point, which is very, very critical point, those who are the leading company, they will say, okay, when we go outside, we are in a very competitive positions. If you are going to introduce SME from Iran within this global value chain, whether you are competitive on the tax system, if I want to invest here, if I want to use your SME, we have to see to what extent your taxing system is competitive. To what extent you have free trade agreement or you have preferential trade agreement, because if I am going to introduce Iran and spare parts, if I am going to introduce Iran and joint manufacture products in my network, in my value chain system, the key point is to what extent you have FTA, free trade agreement, with your partners, with different countries, to be able to do that. To what extent, from the cost analysis, you are competitive. I don't know, for example, how is the salary here for the employee, how much is the other, logistic cost there. So another key point is to what extent we are logistically competitive in order to have such kind of, chances to go within the international framework. I believe maybe country by country has different, barriers in order to join to this global value chain, but from our side and from our experience, first is to what extent the environment is prepared for Iranian foreign trade transactions in regard of FTA and taxes and also cost analysis, and to what extent there is a promotion organizations or a developing organizations to support SME to be having a good positions inside the value chain. Thank you for your attention. I am so sorry. I fixed my program to leave at 1 o'clock because I have a flight. So if I am not able to stay here and to reply to your questions, so please excuse me for that.
thank you for your intervention. And I asked other panelists for patience and to allow me to ask one question and follow up to this this really passionate statement. You mentioned that you believe that it's important that there is a role for the government to provide support, to also assist in the building of institutions or private sector organizations, to assist. But often it's not possible to do all these things at once. And it's something we refer to in our work, where we say sometimes strategic decisions need to be made. We call it strategic decisions rather than planning. Sounds different, it's a bit the same thing. How do you decide where your priorities are, where you intervene first?
As you know, in our economy, some sectors, competitiveness is well known to most of the people that who knows Iran. For example, we are a country with four complete season in the year. We have full summer and spring and winter and autumn with almost 30 to 40 degree temperature difference. So it means at the same time that you are skiing in Tehran, the capital city, at the same time you can go in the south and you can make, swimming. The country has such kind of capacity from the climate situation that gives you the opportunity to have a good fruits with good taste, with good color, with good shape. So if agriculture sector has such kind of comparative advantage, and if you are going to have these fruits within the global value chain, what I am saying, okay, if the government has any kind of developing organization like petrochemical industry that we used to have it, but in the agricultural side, since mostly are in the hands of the private sectors and government is not too much involved, so maybe we may ask the association of the growers, your association of the exporters of the agricultural products, they should be the engine behind the progress and behind the development of such kind of jobs to be done. On the mining sectors, since most of them are in the hands of the government, the mine itself belongs to the government, but the government can also, today it is this case, for example, we have established, we had one company from the past, which we gave him yesterday, one of the speakers from Costa Rica mentioned that the organization and the management should be flexible according to the duties of the day, according to the duties of this time. What is our main responsibility today in a very turbulent, a world in a very technological advances, changes we are witnessing every day. So it means we have to define what could be the new area for the future of the economy. And if, for example, IT is today play a very important role, we have to be flexible in our TPO to establish department in charge of IT, because today it is the subject of the day. I think when we are saying that our policy is more or less dependency on the crude oil and we have to develop our mining sector, so this means we have to have an organization devoted to the expansion of the mining sectors from the designing, from the investment, and from the operation, and everything. So I wanted to be very summarized. Those who are in the hands of government could be followed by the organizations established by the government. And if it is in the hands of private sectors, I believe associations and also federations who bring all these exporters, they can follow the vision, what is the vision for agriculture, what is the vision for IT within 10 years' time, and what steps should be taken by the government, what steps should be taken by the private sectors, how the different implementation should be taken place, and such kind of association should follow all these jobs and all these steps to be taken.
Thank you. I heard a lot of flexibility, dynamism, and I took this down, flexible according to the duties of the day. So this I will take home to Geneva. I thank you very much for having been here with us, and I wish you a good flight back to your country. I will give the floor to the next speaker, Larry Atipu. We realize that we have something in common. He works for an agency, the Fairtrade International, headquartered in Bonn. Now, Bonn is the former capital of my country, Germany, and I come from a city very close by to Bonn. So welcome to this panel, Larry. I introduced you already as the International Development Director of Fairtrade International, but I will read something in your bio which struck me. Larry is a passionate believer in private sector-led, inclusive and sustainable value chain development. So here we have the terms. We already heard private sector-led. We heard this in the previous intervention. Value chains, but sustainable value chains, and you have facilitated the inclusion of communities and SMEs in global value chains. Well, this is what we all want to do here. Given that you have already managed to, please tell us your secret.
Thank you very much, Marion. And let me also join the minute before me in thanking ITC and Maroc Esports for this nice opportunity to exchange. And also for us in fair trade in particular, we are extremely pleased that we get the opportunity to come here and talk about the work we do in sustainable value chain development. We are a voluntary standard setting organization. We set the standards and we have FlowSet, another independent company which then certifies against the standards and audits on an annual basis. And seeing that most of our clients are really small, vulnerable farmers who form themselves into cooperatives and also some plantations, workers on plantations, we do understand the complexity of global value chains to the extent that it is also very difficult for these small people, small groups, to find space in those value chains. Now, some of the challenges they tell us include the ability to understand the complexity of standards, the technicality of standards, being who they are and the facilities they have at their disposal to decipher the meaning of these standards and to work, you know, towards them. Also, because they are small, the scale at which they operate, you know, challenges them in how they interact with these global value chains. The sheer pace of technological changes, you know, challenges them as well. At the same time, they see opportunities. They want to trade. They want to be part of it. They see opportunities in this global movement. But who helps them to do that? That's some of the things that Fairtrade does. So what do we do to help them? We try to explain the standards, the reason for the standards. We put people on the ground to work with them in their space, to understand the standards and to work towards those standards so they can be included in those value chains. Then we provide technical support in the way they do their business, in productivity, in quality, and environmental issues, child labor, how they deal with their workers, and the like. Then, in recent times, we have also noticed that, being that we have been doing this for 25 years, some of the companies that we work with have taken the mantle on themselves to lead in sustainable production and marketing. So they are interacting directly with the cooperatives on the ground. But Fairtrade does not leave them. You may have heard recently the announcement of a partnership between Fairtrade and Mondelez for cocoa in Ghana. So Fairtrade is still there with Mondelez, helping in the formation of these groups, forming them into good business units that do business according to international standards and principles, providing the sustainability element, also focus on people and planet in addition to profit, which is very important. We have also been working with another important company, Ferrero, in Côte d'Ivoire, where we agree on the metrics to measure together with smallholder farmers to show that we are sustainable in the practice, in the production and sale of cocoa, for example. So that these are just but examples of where we move from the narrow lens of certification and auditing to actually working with companies on clear agendas towards sustainability. But the most exciting one in recent times is the one we have been doing with ITC in Ghana also, in the YAM value chain through what we call the Alliances for Change, or for Action, rather. Now here, we recognize that we are not the only interested parties in sustainable production and consumption in the space. So we will work with other partners because we realize it's the smart thing to do. So we have, together with ITC, government, private sector, bankers, anybody who is interested in the production and sale of sustainable yam, we sit around the table, we discuss, we bring our experiences, and we see that this is a really quick way of reaching scale and sustainability. So we are there as well. But in the end, what we like to do is to keep this message that Dr. Kabaruka referred to this morning of sustainable production through focus on people, planet, and in addition to profit, and take it to scale. So we start small, but in 25 years, we have now made a mark on the market because private sector have also recognized this, our partners have recognized this, and without our prompting, are taking the lead, and in some cases, we are following them.
Thank you very much. I had personally the pleasure to also work with the Alliance for Action team around some of the work in Ghana. We are currently finalizing an SME competitiveness report for Ghana because we collected information of the readiness, export readiness, SME competitiveness in the country there. This had the advantage for me that I had a priority access to chocolate from the cacao project there, but definitely a lot of enthusiasm around this alliance of different players to make change happen in the country. Our next speaker is from Brazil, Adriana Rodriguez, competitiveness from APEX Brazil. Adriana, when I think of Brazil, I know that you are world leader at least in one thing where we are competing with you, that's football. We are still behind, but apparently you think there's still work to be done on other area. In other areas. You are notably have been very active on the issue of sustainability, of including women in trade also, and you're responsible for innovation. I look forward to hear from you about APEX Brazil's work.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity of showing our experience in Brazil. APEX has worked since the beginning with industry associations in order to develop capacity building for companies, mainly small companies, and to deliver the traditional promotion tools and help our companies to be more competitive in the market. But we still have a very big challenge, that is to include more companies in the foreign market, in the foreign trade. So we started to help or to understand how our companies would be more competitive in the foreign market. And we launched two important projects that we are working on it now, right now, that are programs that would help, first of all, small companies, we have like more than 70% of our clients or companies that are supported by Apex are small companies. And we launched with another university in Brazil, that is Fundação Getúlio Vargas, that is a think tank, very respected by the sustainability studies. So we had a public call for companies that had solutions in sustainability, so we could help them to improve their skills, the business skills, and also the sustainability practices. And then we helped those companies to have, first of all, missions abroad. They had also a round table in Brazil, so they could find new customers and enter, had the access to the market. The other part of this project was with two Brazilian transnational companies, which had also very innovative solutions in sustainability, and they are very important players in the international market. So we help to enhance their value chain practices in sustainability. So we also had capacity building courses, training with all these companies, so they would help those transnational companies in also be position themselves in the international market. The other program is the Women in Trade program that we have created in a partnership with ITC. We have hosted the Women Vendors Forum in Brazil in 2015, and then we launched the program. So we are now helping the capacity building of women-led companies. We help them also with buyers that were invited to come to Brazil this year to have round tables also. And with that, we have also market intelligence and training and everything so they can enter those markets.
Okay. Thank you very, very much for these insights, Adriana. Our last panelist is Datu Zul from yet another large country, well integrated in global market, Malaysia. Malaysia happens to be one of the first countries I ever worked in the 80s and discovered what planning and assistance of the government means for the export sector. I was working on the rubber exports at the time and discovered that there was an incredible network of agencies throughout the country that would inform smallholders, rubber tappers in the most remote regions about the latest tapping techniques, the latest seeds and the latest standards in the market. So one could see how the information flows from the capital to the rest of the country. But that's many years ago. I expect much has happened since. Based on this long experience in your country, how is Malaysia, how is smart trade dealing with change? How is it looking towards 2025? What will be the role of standards and regulation there? And how are you dealing with it?
Thank you, Marian. Bring back the decades of history of Malaysia exports. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank the Kingdom of Morocco and Maroc Export for hosting this event together with our good friend, our partner is ITC, International Trade Center. I am here because I believe ITC continue to develop the global value chains for everybody here in this room. I'm I'm very indebted to ITC because when I started my career before, I was trained by ITC as well. So I think we have to be positive towards the global value chains. Global value chains can shape the economy, can shape our development. The most importantly, to help our SMEs in the country to grow. And we have to look into this area seriously in order to generate the business for our SMEs and our exporters. As far as Malaysia is concerned, we are moving in from the commodity exporting nations in early, late 50s after we gained independence in 1957 to 60s into the industrialization. And currently, exports of manufacturing products consists of 82% of our total exports. And we are the, you cannot be very proud of that, we are now the 23rd largest exporter in the world. And at the same time also, we are big importers. We are 25th largest importer in the world based on the WTO, and we are the trading nations. In ASEAN, we consider ourselves as number two after Singapore in terms of our economy to exposure to the international trade. The international trade is very important to us. Globalization, global value chain, very important to us. And as you know that in Malaysia, we have many foreign direct investment, FDI. This is because of the global value chains. And Malaysian companies invested abroad because of the global value chains. We in Malaysia, we are nurturing, grooming, helping our SMEs to become a champion, creating the brand, the value for their products, and go to the higher level of global value chains so that they are, don't go into the lower end of the market, must go into middle and up niche market so that they don't have try to avoid a strong competition. At the same time, we are in the region of ASEAN with the 630 million people. 630 million people of 10 countries in ASEAN, and Malaysia only, well, our population only 31 million people. So we have to work within the ASEAN economic community in ASEAN, because ASEAN, as you know, is a vibrant economy. With the 630 million people, we have many free trade agreements signed with the trading partners outside ASEAN, such as China, India, Japan, Korea, Taiwan, Australia, New Zealand. And free trade agreement also very important to create global value chains. And we are looking into global value chains. We are also looking to see how their standards can create barriers for us to go and enter our partner country market. In ASEAN, we try to come up with a mutual recognition agreement among the ASEAN countries. We have to have ASEAN standards so that everybody produce based on the standards, one standards for everybody. And with our trading partner, we are working closely with them, how we can help our exporter, manufacturers, SMEs to fulfill the standards imposed by our major trading partners, such as, for example, in Japan, they have their own standards, Europe, America, and others. So how we work together with them, we bring them into our country to create awareness of our exporters. We also helping them to outreach our community in terms of giving them more in-depth information about standards. And we, as an export promotion agency, or TPOs, we are helping our companies to embrace it to the standards. Of course, a certain support from government need to make available to our SMEs. In Malaysia, SMEs representing 97% of the total businesses in the country. Out of that, I would say 85% of SMEs consist of micro business. We have to grow this micro business owned by the woman, owned by single mother, owned by the youth or young people to become small or to become medium-sized company or to become one day to become mid-tier companies. So all in all, the global value chain can help them to shape their business in direction in terms of to go abroad. because we believe the 31 million population in the country is not sustainable for us. We have to go beyond our border, beyond nations. We have to communicate with them in terms of standards, regulation, in the language they can understand, the words they can understand, how they can translate into their business policy, business strategy, to ensure that their business can be sustainability. They also have to respect the needs of the environment, the needs of their trading partner, at the same time also can help them to grow business. This is part one of what I would like to tell you. But of course, you're talking about rubber. We are leading, used to be a leading rubber, natural rubber exporter, now Sri Lanka and others. It's a leading rubber exporter in the world. But we are controlling 70% of the latex glove in the world. So this is another area we are looking into that. We go to the higher value chains from the natural rubber exporter now to become the finished rubber products to cater the needs of the household, the needs of the medical industry, health industry, by producing the high rubber value products. The same thing on in terms of electrical electronic. We have to go to higher value chains. We used to be, 20 years ago, the largest air-conditioned exporter in the world. But now it's no longer Malaysia. We are now looking into more into electrical electronic, talking about a smartphone in your pocket. Perhaps 30% of the contents in your smartphone coming from Malaysia. Either you are using Apple, or you are using Samsung, or you are using Huawei, because the technology itself, through the global value chain, help us, help the country, help the industry to change the direction into the higher value-added products. Thank you.
I have, after these inventions, plenty of questions I would like to ask you, and I will ask you follow-up questions, but I've also been asked by the organizers to stick to time and to actually shorten the session. I will want to stop the session at 1:30, and that gives us 20 more minutes. So if you allow me, I would like to ask the public now whether they have questions, and then I will weave those questions into the follow-up discussion here on the podium. So if anybody in the audience has questions to ask to the panelists, please raise your hand. If you are in the middle, towards the back, you may have to go to the sides because I do not see the middle back part from here because of the lights. So any questions you would like to ask, please let us know. No questions now, that's good for me. Then I ask questions. Indira, we just heard this statement, Asia is very dynamic, Asia growing, and definitely from where I live in Europe, that's the way it looks. That 2025, Asia is definitely going to be there. And one thing that sounded very confident and in your intervention was this embracing the standards agenda to such an extent that you become a standard setter of your own. You mentioned the Lankan's standard. I remember the event when we had an event in Colombo recently, an intervention by Dilmati, who said also we became from somebody who meets standards, over complies with standard, we are a standard setter now. How come you feel so confident about being able to do this? Well, how important is it for you to have an active, proactive role for this?
As I mentioned, the Sri Lankan market is very limited. So we have to look at the global market. For example, we are looking at, our strategy now is looking at regional markets, not too far away, which is close by. So based on the regional markets, our government is very active in doing a few free trade agreements. We have already one with India and Pakistan, the only country in the world that has with India and Pakistan. Then we are also dealing with China now. We are negotiating with China and we are negotiating with Singapore. So when you have all these free trade agreements coming, you open the markets, and that is only the import duties that you have a concession. The majority is import duties or whatever quotas they may give you. But how do you organize your supply base to enter those markets? I'll take a classic example of we have numerous non-tariff barriers and SPS barriers with India. So having opened up the market access with free trade agreements, unless we have the SPS and NTB standards also attended to, opening of that market does not benefit our exporters. So as mentioned by Daito, we are working with India on a mutual recognition agreement, because we have had instances where it's certified by companies like SGS in Sri Lanka, but when it enters the shores of India, the SGS certificate is not accepted. So that is trouble for an SME sector, especially if you are doing something like processed food or perishables. You are very confident you expect export it with the SGS certificate, and your buyer says the certificate is accepted. But once you get there, when that is not accepted, that is trouble. So therefore, we thought we should work very closely with the Indian government. And in fact, we have got the Food Safety Authority to come to Sri Lanka, sit with us, go through with us one by one some of the non-tariff barriers that our exporters have faced in the last 4 years. Because we are trying to deepen the agreement with India, but our exporters are not too happy to deepen the agreement unless we have sorted the NTB and SPS barriers. So therefore, it becomes extremely important, Sri Lanka being a small market, and we are in the process of having several FTAs worked out, that we have all these standards in place, and the standards that Sri Lankan companies have to maintain are also accepted outside. So this is why one small example I gave was the Sri Lankan gap. Now, Sri Lankan farmers may have had traditional good manufacturing practices, because some of our farmers by default are also organic, purely because they have not used fertilizer. So that is a tremendous advantage to Sri Lanka because of the fact that they didn't use fertilizer and it was all organic, that we have been also been able to enter the organic market. But it was important that those who were growing commercially and the smaller farmers were given the good agriculture practices right from the start, because there is no point in having standards at the end of the series of activity that you do, because the good agriculture practices must start from the time they sow the seeds. It cannot be done at the time they harvest. So therefore, we took this initiative and worked with the ITC to get the local Sri Lankan gap first given to Sri Lankan farmers, because that will not only give safe food for the export market, it will also give safe food to our own people. Why are we having standards, different standards when it has to go for export, especially food products? Different standards when you have to export, and different standards for our own people. So it's very important that they know what minimum residue levels are, that they don't over-fertilize. It becomes far more economic also when you know the correct procedures of fertilizing. Because usually the tendency of farmers is if you double fertilize that, you might get a double crop on that, which is not the case. So I'm sure it's common to most of us here. So it is very important that we educate the farmers at that level, and this is why the Lankan gap is working very well. Because when if they have to get to the export market, they have also followed the procedures, and getting the global gap becomes so much easier for them. So similarly, we are trying to have different standards done within Sri Lanka using our regulators so that they are prepared for exports. Because today we spoke of the keynote, he spoke of you can have market access, but if your supply is not ready, that market access is useless to us.
Thank you. One thing I'm interested in, I will remain in the region and come back to that, to Zul, is this this positive references you make to multilateral recognition, collaboration with your partners, even an ASEAN standard. In the European Union, we are right now in a situation where there is a bit of opposition against rules being set in, like standards being set in Brussels, mutual recognition being imposed by regional courts. There seems to be more enthusiasm for regionalism in the Asian region. Would you see it this way, and less concern about harmonization and mutual recognition?
Well, harmonization and mutual recognition must come together and in hand, because well, they can help our companies to have a better market access. But what we are doing now is to ensure that the government, when they go and discuss about the free trade agreement, go to other regional fora, the standards, NTM, NTBs, need to be addressed to help the business to grow. We are not only looking into the standards for the products, but also standard on services, because Malaysia as a country, we have to push more for the export services such as ICT products, medical and medical services, talking about construction, engineering, architecture, accounting. This is the area sometimes may take time to discuss to get the recognition. Despite of these people, they have same qualification, the same institute to govern the bodies of professional services. So this is need to be addressed. We know that it may take some time, but we continue to ensure that we have to make inroad into the services sector. And many of us may be looking into services is something new, particularly to our fellow friends from the country in Africa, in other parts of the world. But we sooner or later, we have to go for the services sector. To be a developed nation, we have to be a services sector, because services, including the tourism sectors. If you look into the tourism, sometimes the trade deficit, but the country still doing well because the services sector, tourism, helping the country to grow further. So we cannot, differentiate between push more effort to promote sort of products, but they have to also looking into seriously into the services sector, where the talent, the people in our country, one day they can become exporter of services sector. There's another scenario we have to look into the standards and regulation to help the country to grow.
Larry, back to agriculture from services. We mentioned harmonization. When we think harmonization, we often think of harmonization of governmental standards, of rules, governments agreeing. But in this fair trade sustainability standards world, we are often not dealing with governmental rules. We are dealing with private sector standards or NGO rules. And there is also a fair amount of diversity there that can be a problem for both consumers who don't know anymore what is fair and what is environmentally friendly, and for producers, I assume, who have to decide which particular standard to meet. Is this issue of diversity of standards, is this a concern? Is this an issue in your work?
Absolutely. It's a big concern, also because we are told by our clients that it is very difficult for them to be fair trade and maybe ooze or rainforest and other standards together, even though they think they need all of them. So I think we are progressing through the ICIL Alliance. There's a lot of conversation right now on how to recognize each other's standards to a certain extent, so people only need to build on to reduce the cost of certification and staying certified. And I think that it's not only the producers that demand it. I think there's also a loud voice coming from the market side of things as well. In the end, standards or being certified should not become a barrier, as the case may be. I think that this situation has arisen because everybody has been looking at standards through their narrow definition of what is good, and it's also become quite competitive. But as I say, we have recognized it, and through the ICIL Alliance, there's this strong conversation going on. Fairtrade is open to it. We have a work stream currently as part of a strategy dedicated to collaboration and recognition of standards. So in the not too distant future, I think that this space will be better. And in fact, it should also be cheaper for producers to abide by standards.
It's interesting you mentioned ICL. We also found in a recent study we produced on voluntary sustainability standards, we found that the role of ICL membership can really contribute to reducing the costs for producers meeting a standard. These voluntary sustainability standards, these sustainability issues, they are often perceived as something that comes from the industrialized world. And we found in that same study that this is less and less the case, that increasingly emerging economies are setting standards too, or have headquarters of standards. Now, I presented that finding some weeks ago in a panel with a Brazilian representative, and she said to me, "Oh, this is just these are just Western companies setting up headquarters in Brazil, and then it looks like a Brazilian standard." Adriana, how is this? How do you see this issue? Is sustainability standard setting Brazil something that Brazil embraces to such an extent that it considers to proactively also design, set those standards? Or is this something that is coming from abroad, from your partners?
Well, I think that our companies, mainly the exporting companies, accept the international standards. We are working with those companies, and I think that as a TPO, we have a very important, responsibility to help companies to understand, be aware of the international standards so they can be more competitive also. But in APEX, we are doing a very good, coordination with other agencies and government to help companies to set, be able to respect those international standards. So I think that, of course, we have some standards for our market, let's put this way, but we also are supporting our companies to understand and to be certificated by the international standards. Of course, there is a problem of the costs for it, and I think that we have different certifications, and sometimes we see for our coffee industry, for example, we have some companies that have the fair trade, the others have other standards, and sometimes it's difficult for a small company. So maybe we could, as international trade and promotion agencies, work on, just one for each sector that could be accepted and could be the standard for all our companies that are in the market, in the international market. I think it would be nice if we could work on that. And not having all these different certifications. It's very difficult for the small companies, and also if you want to have a more inclusive international market, we should work on that. I think it would be a good challenge for us, our TPOs, right?
So that's a piece of homework that we'll take with us to Geneva. ITC is actually active in this area with these voluntary standards. I mentioned that the information comes from a platform. We have the standards map, where so far we compare standards. An SME that exports can see if I want to meet a Swiss fair trade standard and also the German one, how different are these things? So at least there is more transparency. And what we do see is an interest also often sometimes now from retailers, from larger companies to adjust these things and to bring them closer to make them more similar, to go in the direction of harmonization. But there's more to be done, and we will definitely take that invitation up and continue continue to work on this topic. Time is running. I don't know whether that's a problem with my watch, but we are close to the, I think, to the end of this session. I will want to give the speakers, each speaker, a possibility to give a one-minute final statement. Maybe think about what you consider to be the priority in your area of work in order for your country to meet the standards for trade in 2025, be able to enter international markets and global value chains, not only now, but also in the future. In the meantime, while you think about your closing statement, let me give some of the takeaways for me from this session, apart from the demand, and I saw Ms. Malvate nodding for maybe one international standard per sector. I heard a lot about the need to talk among agencies, regulators, with trade agencies, with the private sector in order to handle the standards regulation agenda. I heard market access is not just something you sign, you get through an agreement. The companies need to have the capacity to meet standards and regulations, have to be able to certify it. That's often a problem. And I heard a lot about the need to be strategic about to think how to do this and where to set priorities, whether it's in Iran or whether it's making the next move towards services in Malaysia. So I will move maybe from the outer end closer to me. Larry, you have 60
seconds. Yes, so for fair trade, in addition to our commitment to collaborate with other schemes to make standards more affordable, compliance with standards more affordable for the entire value chain. We also have as an objective to work towards living income for producers in the value chains, because this is also very important, and also living wage for people on plantations, because when we talk about sustainability, we have to really try to see if we are actually internalizing all costs in the production process. So we do need to look at living income and living wage. And so 2020, that's what we want to contribute to globalized value chains.
Adriana.
I would say and contribute with a word. I think it's coordination. Maybe we should have this challenge as CPOs to have this coordination among our companies in our markets and also internationally, so we can have more sustainable value chains, and also the standards would be more, let's say, fair or more spread out and acceptable for everybody.
Thank you. Coordination, Ms. Malvate?
I think as responsible TPOs who are represented here, we should all look at the requirements of our SMEs actively and look at the standards that are necessary for the different products and services. And as TPOs, take the lead and help all of them to meet the necessary standards. Because sometimes it's a knowledge gap that is there, or sometimes it may be financial, it may be that they don't know whom to contact. So I think as responsible TPOs, we should take it on ourselves, especially to help the SME sector to meet international standards.
Thank you.
We are in this room. We would like to do more business, more trade, more to increase the value of our exports, to help our SMEs, to help our country to grow. Let us talk. Let us do something to help our companies. Together, we try to be transparent. We try to make sure that the standards we are going to practice to impose to our trading partners is not going to create problem to our own exporters. If we talk, we work together, I'm sure we can have a standard mutually agreed by everybody. We can harmonize it. We can help our SMEs to grow further with the help of our ITC. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks also for mentioning ITC at the end. A call for sustainability we had, a call for coordination, a call for leadership, a call for action. I think this is a beautiful way to end the panel. Please join me in thanking our panelists.
Thank you, our distinguished panelists. Thank you very much, Marion, for the moderation of this session. Please, on your way out, do not forget to deposit your votes for the hosting of the 2018 TPO Network World Conference and Awards. The voting box is in the ITC booth as you leave the room on your right hand. This will be your last chance to vote. Also, lunch will take place as yesterday in the Hotel du Golf restaurant, but because we're running late, can I please ask you to be here at 2:30 sharp? Thank you very much. Bon appétit.